Welcome to the Sustainable Development E-Talks series co-hosted by CNS and Indian Institute of Management, Indore. We have with us today Ramon Magsaysay awardee, Dr. Sandeep Pandey, who is a noted climate activist. A PhD from University of California, Dr. Pandey has taught in several Indian Institutes of Technology and Indian Institutes of Management, plus in other universities in India and abroad. But I'm sure many of our audiences would be quite chuckled to hear that he never took their examination in the conventional sense of the word. We will talk to him about this maybe later on. Dr. Pandey has led several foot marches against use of nuclear energy and in support of a just and social order. He has led National Alliance of People's Movements. And in 2019 and 2018, when heads of 194 countries met at the UN General Assembly to discuss abolition of nuclear weapons, the only Indian non-government voice invited to be in the room was that of Dr. Sandeep Pandey. Dr. Pandey will share his insights on why energy democracy is key for sustainable development and why sustainable societies are not possible without a nuclear-free world.
A very warm welcome to Dr. Sandeep Pandey on behalf of the Indian Institute of Management, Indore. Sir, we are indeed privileged to have you here on Sustainable Development eTalks and are really looking forward to interacting with you on energy democracy. Over to you, Dr. Pandey.
The reason we have to talk about this subject is because, you know, there is energy crisis. Energy crisis in two ways. First of all, the resources are getting depleted. That is something we have been hearing about since I was a child, that, you know, one day the coal reserves will get over or the petroleum reserves will get over. But it hasn't happened so far and doesn't look like it's going to happen in near future, because you know always discover new reserves of coal and petroleum. But the other serious problem which has arisen in recent times is that of carbon emission. And because of carbon emission now, people are saying that we have to switch to more, methods of producing energy which do not emit carbon. In fact, some societies like the European society has committed itself to become a no carbon society till 2050. Similarly, Japan is also trying to be a no carbon society, which means they will not emit carbon dioxide or carbon monoxide in near future, the way they are planning their fulfillment of their energy needs. So, but what is the situation in India, or even most of the world? Even now, we are basically using fossil fuels to meet our energy requirements. In India, most of the energy needs, I think, close to 70% is fulfilled by coal, and then the remaining is fulfilled by hydroelectric, and a small part, which is now growing big, but it is not big enough. It is not, certainly not more than 10%. In fact, it will be lower because the capacity may be greater, but it may not be producing energy. For example, you have windmills. Now, they will function only when the wind is blowing. So you have a capacity of 2,000 to 3,000 megawatts of producing electricity on the coast of Tamil Nadu. But whether you are actually getting 2,000 to 3,000 megawatts at every point in time is not certain. So the capacity may be greater, but the energy, electricity from the renewable sources is not that that much. It is only a very small part of our energy supply. But most of the countries are now moving towards replacing fossil fuel based energy plants or the hydroelectric dams, hydroelectric power plants by either solar or wind or bio or some form of renewable energy. There is this question of, so that is amply clear and that we see happening. There is a debate about whether nuclear energy can be classified as safe energy. And a lot of countries which are pushing nuclear energy give this argument that nuclear energy is safe because there is no carbon emission and that it can replace coal. But nuclear energy has other problems which tend to be underestimated or people don't like to talk about it. But the reality is that most of the Europe and the United States is now not setting up new nuclear power plants. In fact, the only countries which are going ahead aggressively pursuing nuclear energy are India and China, except for these two countries. Most of the countries have either not entered the field at all, like Australia, or are not building new power plants, even if they were in the past aggressively pursuing nuclear energy. For example, France, a major portion of energy in France comes from nuclear energy, but now they are not building any more plants. And the reason why they're not building new plants is because the accidents in Chernobyl, Three Mile Island, and Fukushima have shown that they can be very dangerous. In fact, the difference between an accident in a nuclear power plant and in any other kind of industrial unit is that the accident in nuclear power plant will cause immediate damage, but as well as long-term damage, because the radiation which will be released, the radioactive material which will be released, will continue to radiate for a long time to come and can be harmful for human beings. And this is what we have to understand. I mean, vast area of agricultural land in around Chernobyl has been destroyed. The water has been polluted. Same is the case with Fukushima. People who are living nearby are still exposed to all the radiation, and there is really no way to contain it. The best solution to the problem of radioactivity is to not mine uranium at all. Uranium is the only natural material which can provide nuclear energy. In the fission of uranium atom, we also get plutonium, which can also be used to produce energy. Now people are saying that the best way to deal with uranium or even coal is to just leave it in the ground. Don't take it out. Don't mine it. And we believe that that is how it should be, because if you mine coal, you are going to burn it. That will create the problem of carbon emission. If you mine uranium, it will be fissioned and it will give rise to the problem of radioactivity. Let me just tell you how dangerous it is by going over a slideshow. So Bobby, will you share the slideshow with the people who are there? You can put one slide after the other and I can continue speaking. I am using a different computer to see my slideshow presentation. Yeah. So nobody knows how dangerous it is officially, because no government will ever admit that radioactivity is dangerous, at least not the Indian government. In United States, there have been studies which have shown that number of people who have been affected by radiation in over 300 installations related to nuclear power plants. They have 104 nuclear power plants or nuclear weapon production centers. The number of people who have been affected and died is more than the people who were killed in Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombing, which means the United States has killed more of its citizens in the process of producing nuclear energy and nuclear weapon or doing research on that than it has killed with the bombs, by dropping the bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. In India, the Uranium Corporation of India Limited, which is a body which mines uranium, says on its website that there is no adverse effect on health of residents around Jadugoda. Jadugoda is the place where uranium mining takes place in India. But there have been two studies, both non-government, and they have to be, because government will never do a study like this. So one is by people known to us. There is a physics PhD from IIT Kanpur, Surendra Gadekar, and his wife, Sangmitra Gadekar, who is a doctor. And she was on some panel which went to look into the damages caused by the Chernobyl accident in USSR at that time. And the husband-wife team has conducted a survey near the Rawatbhatta nuclear power plant, which is in Rajasthan, and have come up with results, which I will share with you very soon. And then there is Indian Doctors for Peace and Development, which is actually the Indian chapter of an international organization, International Physicians for Prevention of Nuclear War, which actually got Nobel Peace Prize, several years ago for their campaign against nuclear weapons. So IDPD is the Indian chapter of that international organization, and they have conducted a similar survey like the Gadekars have done in Rajasthan in Jadugoda, from where India mines its uranium in Jharkhand. Can we go to the next slide? So there is really no safe level of radioactivity. And if you look at the information that is given here, you will realize why we are saying this. After the Chernobyl accident, Romania declared that 185 becquerel per liter, iodine-131, the isotope of iodine-131, was considered as safe, whereas another country in Europe, Sweden, had set a limit of 2000 becquerels per liter. So you see the difference. And the actual levels in the milk had risen to 2900 becquerels per liter. Exposure to even low level radiation can result in genetic damage to offspring, benign and malignant tumors, premature aging, and shortened lifespan. Next. Rawatbhatta nuclear power plant in Rajasthan, survey was conducted by the Gadekars, as I mentioned. So the way they did their survey is they chose these 2,860 people within 10 kilometers of the plant, and they chose about a similar number, 2,544, 50 kilometers away. So that was their control group. And they asked the same set of questions and then they compared the results. And you can see the results that 25% people in distant area, the control population, reported some illness, whereas 45% in the area near the plant. In 68 households in the area near to the plant, one member reported 4 ailments, and it happened only in 9 households in the area far away. And 2 to 3 times more people with average age 10 years younger reported chronic ailments in the area near to the plant. Solid tumors were seen on the bodies, 30 cases near the plant and 5 in the control population. Women and children are the worst affected. Next slide, can we go to that? So untoward pregnancy outcomes, higher number of miscarriages, stillbirths, deaths among newborn, congenital deformities. These are the common problems that were seen both in Rawatbhatta and in Jadugoda. So 50 congenital deformities in 45 children were found near the plant, and only 14 deformities in 14 children in control villages. So which means one child had only one deformity, whereas here at least 5 children had more than one deformity. Deformity in those above 18 years was 5 near the plant, 4 away from the plant, so not much difference. But in less than 11 years, there were 36 cases near the plant and only 6 in the control population. So you can see that it affects the children more. Children were affected more by the radiation. And that is also clear from the next data. 7 infants died within a day of birth near the plant in 2 years. Just 1 died in distant villages. There were 6 stillbirths near the plant, whereas no stillbirths in the faraway area. And death after a week, 9 in nearby villages, 7 in control villages. So not much of a difference there, but there is a significant difference in other figures. Now, authorities claim that all these problems, health problems, were because of poverty and malnutrition and unsanitary living conditions, which, you know, any poor population in India living in slum can be accused of these things. But we know that nobody likes to be malnourished, or nobody likes to live in unsanitary conditions if they can help it. People have to live in those conditions because they have no running water, they have no toilet, you know, things we take for granted. Those basic facilities are not there in the areas, and therefore, for example, in the current epidemic, or what is called pandemic, you know, my doctor's friend tell me that whenever you go out, you should come, you know, remove all your clothes, take a bath with hot water, and immediately wash your clothes with hot water. And you should do it every time you enter your house. Use sanitizer every time. Even somebody like me can't do it, because sometimes I'm coming back at 12 in the night, 2 in the night. It is not possible to do it for me every time, even though I have the facility. And just imagine if you give these instructions to people living in slums, how are they ever being able to do it? I mean, they don't even have water. What to talk about hot water? And where will they wash their clothes in hot water? So it is not possible for people to practice the kind of hygiene that, you know, is expected. And therefore, you know, this is not something which is only peculiar to people living near Rawatbhatta. It is everywhere. The point is that even the control population which was chosen was not very different from this population. In fact, the people near the plant had more income because, you know, they could do various things like run a shop or provide some service to the people working in the plant to earn money. Whereas people in the control villages did not have that much cash income. And in fact, they were more exposed to pesticides because they were doing farming. Even then, you can see that the extent of diseases, various kinds of diseases, is more in the people living near the plant. So can we go to the next slide? Now the mining and milling operations happen in Jadugoda. Milling is the next process after mining. And this is a tribal area. Santhal, Munda and Ho are the tribes which live in this area. And it is a coincidence, but most of the minerals, not just in India, on this earth are where tribals live. I mean, I don't know how this happened, but this is a coincidence that whether it is Australia, whether it is Africa, whether it is India, whether it is Canada or the US, it so happens that, you know, minerals are there where tribals are, and you can almost, you know, superimpose the two maps of tribal population and minerals. And this is also one such area. And so the people who are, which means that, you know, any operation of mining that you're doing, the ill effects of that will have to be borne by the tribals. Whereas the benefits from those will be derived by mostly non-tribal urban population. So that these tribal people have to pay the price for mining of uranium. And whereas people like us sitting far away in cities, who are not exposed to radiation like the tribals there are, they enjoy the benefits of electricity which is produced from the nuclear power plants. Now the UCIL CMO, Chief Medical Officer for 25 years, Dr. A.N. Malik, claims that he has not come across a single radiation related case in his career. Why? Because if you have any of those diseases that I mentioned earlier, cancer, tumor, there is no way to tell that it is because of radiation. Unless you have some baseline data, which we obviously don't have. And then we have to conduct studies like this, where you choose a control population and compare your results with that. So all the cases of such diseases, most of them were classified as tuberculosis by the doctors there. And that is what the doctors told us when we visited the hospital there, the government hospital, that there are a lot of TB cases, but no radiation related cases. Studies from around the world have shown that lung cancer, the incidence of lung cancer increases because of radon. Radon is also a radioactive gas which is produced during the mining operation. And the IDPD study has found that infertility, stillbirth, abortion, congenital deformity as cause of death, chronic lung disease, and cancer as cause of death, and life expectancy are more in this area compared to the control population that they chose to study. If we go to the next slide, we will see the results. This study was conducted in 2007. Bobby, can we go to the next slide? So this covered 9,511 people from within 2.5 kilometer of mines, tailing ponds, mills. Tailing pond is where you're supposed to keep the waste radioactive material underwater, and milling, as I said, is the process next to mining, which separates the uranium from other things. And the control population was the percentage of uranium, by the way, in the rocks that are mined is very small. So there is a lot of wastage which is generated in the milling process. And when we went there, we saw that all that waste, which was part of the, at one point with uranium, part of the radioactive material, is being used for construction of roads. So you can imagine if some traces of radioactive material were left in the waste, they are going into the construction of the roads. And you can imagine how people would be exposed who are using those roads. So control population in this case was 30 to 35 kilometer away. And the results are that 4.49% mothers reported congenital deformities in their children in nearby villages compared to 2.49% in control villages. So that is not much of a difference. But if you look at the next figure, 9.25% mothers reported congenital deformities as cause of death compared to only 1.71% in the control villages. And 9.6% couples had not conceived after 3 years of marriage compared to 6.27% in control villages. 2.87% households reported cause of death as cancer compared to 1.89% in control villages. And 68.33% deaths were happening before 62 years of age compared to 53.94% in the control population. So not much of a difference except for the death due to congenital deformities. But you can see that in all cases, the incidence of disease and death is higher in the population living near the near Jadugoda. What are the other issues? Women have reported repeated abortions. High prevalence of pulmonary TB and treatment going on for a long time. So even after treatment, it is not getting treated, which means it may be something else besides TB, or maybe something else altogether, which is being diagnosed as TB. On 24th October 2006, there was an accident. Thousands of liters of radioactive waste spilled in a creek because of a pipe burst at UCIL facility, and there was no alarm. So the authorities did not know that there was an accident. It was the people who went and told them that, look, you have an accident. There's a pipe leaking. And then they discovered that, you know, radioactive spill was coming out of that pipe. And till 90s, the tailing ponds, which are supposed to be storage for the radioactive waste, and which are supposed to be underwater, were being used by children as playground and by cattle for grazing. So you can imagine how you know, insensitive or how you know, the authorities simply don't care about the tribal population there and their exposure to radiation. In fact, there's a film called Buddha Weeps in Jadugoda. And if you see that, the name of the film is because the first Indian nuclear test in 74, when it was carried out, Buddha smiles is the code word which was used by the scientists to convey to Indira Gandhi, the then Prime Minister, that the nuclear test was successful. So making a mockery of that that phrase, Buddha Weeps in Jadugoda is a film about the suffering of people in Jadugoda because of the radiation. And in that film, you will see that there are laborers carrying radioactive material on top of their head, and there is liquid, you know, dropping on their face, there are nearly really no safeguards being followed there to protect people from radioactivity. And only now, with these studies and lot of our demonstrations and protests, the authorities have become slightly more you know, careful. They try to follow more norms than they were doing earlier of safeguard. But still, we are far away from protecting our people from radiation. And we intend to increase our capacity of nuclear power production, which is not very good for the local populations wherever the plants will be set up. And therefore, wherever the plants are intended to be set up, local people are protesting. In fact, people in Gujarat were successful in Mithi Virdi, forcing a U.S. company, I think it was General Electric or a company from France to buy up, and then the plant was relocated to Andhra Pradesh. And even in Andhra, there are protests against the uranium mining attempts and other such activities. So in Kodamkulam, we have had big protests led by SP Uday Kumar, who I believe either was a speaker or is going to be a speaker on this series at some point. And there have been, you know, other protests at other places in Gorakhpur in Haryana, where a nuclear power plant is going to be set up. In Bengal, Haripur, the West Bengal government decided to abandon that project. So people are slowly becoming aware, especially after the Fukushima accident. And now they don't want a nuclear power plant in their vicinity. So I think that is where I will close, because we should have some time for interaction. So I primarily chose to speak on nuclear energy and the problems with it. But if you have any other questions related to the issue of energy democracy, I will be happy to take it.
Thank you very much, Sandeep ji, for opening our eyes to the hazards of nuclear energy, which many of us still think is a very good option. We now open for question and answer session. Participants, please raise your virtual hand to ask your question or type in your question in the chat box. And I'm sure you must be having very many questions on your mind already. So please feel free to interact. And Sandeep bhai, what alternate energy sources would you suggest to replace fossil fuel energy? And I would just like to add there that we have a movement running called Feminist Fossil Fuel Free Future.
Yeah.
And we are all aiming for that. So apart from that, what is your take on what are the safe alternate energy sources?
Yeah, so I'm glad you asked that question, because the answer is in two parts. The first part is the model that we have been following is chasing the energy demand. You know, we come up with new uses of electricity, and our modern lifestyle, which now has come into question because of the COVID-19 crisis, this consumerist lifestyle. We have been raising these issues for a long time, but you know, they were never in the mainstream. They were never a matter of concern for the mainstream. But only now, people are beginning to question, you know, the lifestyle associated with the paradigm of modern development. So first is a question that I would like to ask the participants here is whether all our energy needs are genuine. Tell me, why do we make architecture now so that, you know, we need lights during the day, or we need, you know, we can't live without air conditioners. There are a number of things like we do for which we need electricity. If we do it in some other way, we may not need it. For example, you know, day and night cricket matches. Now, what is the need of playing the cricket match in night, you know, by lighting the stadium when you can do it during the daytime? So there are, you will, if you move around in the night, you know, which I often do, see, after about 10 p.m., the traffic on the road is reduced to 5 or 10% of what it is during the daytime. And from there till early morning, till it becomes light, you will see these big, you know, advertisement boards lighted up all night. I mean, what is the use of advertisement being lighted in the night, all during the night, you know, midnight to 2 o'clock in the morning? So there are, you know, I mean, we are wasting electricity because of the lifestyle that we have adopted. I mean, there are villages who don't get any electricity at all. Their children have to study by lighting a kerosene lamp or something like that, and which affects their eyesight, and which they can't do for very long. They have to go to sleep early. And here we are wasting electricity. So my point is that, first of all, we have to, you know, curtail our electricity demand and use it judiciously. For example, all architecture should be such that during the daytime, we should not have to light our bulbs or use, you know, air conditioners. And there are, you know, buildings coming up like that. For example, I got an opportunity to teach at IIT Gandhinagar some time back. And the director there, Professor Sudhir Jain, has made sure that all the offices and the rooms are well lighted, so that, you know, during daytime you don't have to use the light. And the architecture is such that there is Sabarmati River next to it. There is no water in that. That is a different matter. But the breeze which flows is used to circulate through the buildings, so that in the mess there, I saw that there is no air conditioner. There is an exhaust fan which sucks the air in such a way that the air circulation keeps the mess hall, you know, such that you don't need any air conditioners. So our lifestyle should be changed, especially taking a lesson from this crisis, so that our energy requirements are reduced. And secondly, whatever energy requirements are there, we should try to fulfill it by using renewable sources as much as we can. Now I see that a lot of rooftops have solar panels installed. People have these solar water heaters, not the photovoltaic one, just using the thermal energy, because photovoltaic is also costly. The best is to directly use solar energy to heat. So number of devices people are now beginning to use, which a country like India, which is essentially a tropical country, should have started using these technologies, you know, since a long time. Then we would not have required so much of coal and fossil fuels to fulfill our energy needs. So the alternatives are there. We have to just use them. And we have to consciously change our lifestyle so that our dependence on fossil fuels reduces, and we begin to use more and more of renewable energy, the natural light and the natural air in our lives. Okay. So that is a brief reply.
Thank you very much. And, you know, I'm reminded of the houses in the IIT Kanpur campus. I have lived there, and I found the houses used to be so cold during winters and so hot during summers, because of their construction style. Yeah. And probably they were imitating the US style of construction, which does not fit with our...
That is true. Yes. In fact, if you go to the rural areas, the houses which are built of mud are such that, you know, you will have an opposite experience of what you were describing of IIT Kanpur.
Right. We have many questions which have come up. Nisha Tiwari wants to ask an interesting question. It has got nothing to do with nuclear energy. Nisha, would you like to ask your question? Nisha wants to know why Dr. Sandeep Pandey never took exams of his students. We all remember the stress of exams, those who have been through it.
Because I believe that the first time I taught was at IIT Kanpur in 1992. And since then I have taught at IITs in Gandhinagar, at BHU, at Nalsar, Hyderabad. I am currently teaching a course on social movements at National Law University, Delhi, and I go to teach a course on social movements at IIM Ahmedabad every year now. This course happens in June, and this time, because it has been postponed, it will happen in July. So in none of the courses I have taught, whether they were engineering courses or social sciences courses, I have taken a position that as a professor, my responsibility is to make my students understand what I'm teaching, and conducting examinations and passing and failing students is not my job. If somebody wants to do it, I don't have any problem, but I will not do it. So let me tell you what I used to do in my engineering courses, which there is less a scope for experimentation as it is there in social sciences course. In social sciences, I obviously ask them to go to the field and do various things. For example, in Ahmedabad, they go and study the pollution of Sabarmati River and suggest ways to mitigate it. But in engineering courses, what I did was I would teach the subject, and during the course, I tried in a semester at least 3 times to meet every student to find out whether the student was able to understand what I was teaching in the class. And that used to happen over one-to-one interaction. When classes were big, like in BHU, 120 students in a class, then I used to have 2 or 3 students sit down with me. I would give them a question in front of me and I will ask them to solve it. If they were not able to do it, then I would give them another chance. And if they did not do it properly, even the second time, they would get a third chance, and so on. So until they had understood the subject, this process would go on, this process of evaluation. And when I was convinced that they had understood the subject, the evaluation would complete and they would get A grade if they had understood the subject properly. So in my experience, most of the class, by the end of these interactions, was able to pick up the subject. There were always some students, but a very small number, 2 to 4 students in every class, who were not interested in the subject at all. I used to teach control systems, which is a subject common between mechanical, electrical, and chemical engineering. Now, some of the students, and they would tell me that I'm not interested in this subject. So I would not fail them, because my argument was that if somebody has come to IIT, obviously, they have some intelligence, and if they're not interested in this subject, maybe they're interested in something else, and they should not be punished for not being interested in some subject. So I don't think anybody should be failed. Nobody is born to be failed. Everybody has an interest, and they should be allowed to pursue their interest. So that is how I have conducted my classes in all these institutions. And fortunately, most of the times, the directors were supportive. Sometimes, some faculty members complain. But overall, the amount of time and the energy effort that I invest is worthwhile for me as well as my students. So there has not been any major problem. In my social sciences courses, I like to make them do things. For example, in the social movements class, they would interact with some social activist and learn about the movement that the activist is involved in, and then share it with the class in a final presentation. I believe that examinations have nothing to do with learning. The process of education is all about learning. Examinations may be needed when somebody has to select a small number of candidates from a larger pool. So some institution which is giving them admission for higher education, or some company which is, or agency which is going to select students for some job, they can conduct their examination. I have no problem with that, because they are looking for certain talent. So they can conduct their tests. But during the during the process of education, during the process of learning, I feel that examinations are actually unhealthy because they promote competition, which is a negative tendency, as we have learned in this pandemic also. It has become very clear that in cooperation and not competition is what is needed for human beings to survive. So we should not do anything which will promote competition, and that is unhealthy. And then the students start using unfair means if we promote competition. So those are the reasons why I don't use examinations in my class.
Thank you very much on that. We have Dr. Vijay Kumar from IIT BHU with us today. Dr. Vijay Kumar, would you like to say something? Your comments or any questions?
Yes. Very good evening to you. This is Dr. Vijay here.
Yeah, kaise hain Vijay bhai?
Bahut acche hain bhaiya, kaise hain aap?
Haan, main theek hoon, ji ji.
Bahut acha laga jab main dekha ki aapka webinar hone wala hai. Ji ji. Maine turant register kiya aur मौका जाने नहीं दिया.
बहुत अच्छा
जी भैया. ये हम जान सकते हैं कि क्या न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी का सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल को अचीव करने में कोई रोल नहीं है?
देखिए, न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी का तो नहीं है, क्योंकि जैसा मैंने बताया कि न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी से समस्याएं ज्यादा हैं, और जितना पैसा हमको लगाना पड़ता है उसमें
जी,
वो कोयले और पन बिजली से जो बिजली बनाई जाती है उससे कहीं ज्यादा है. अगर आप उसकी पूरी कॉस्ट इंक्लूड करेंगे, मतलब माइनिंग से लेके और न्यूक्लियर पावर प्लांट जब खत्म हो जाएगा 40-50 साल बाद, उसकी लाइफ उतनी ही होती है. उसके बाद उसको डीकमीशन भी करना पड़ता है. एक गोले के कारखाने को या बांध को तो आप ऐसे ही छोड़ सकते हैं, लेकिन जब न्यूक्लियर पावर प्लांट आप बंद करेंगे तो आपको ये सुनिश्चित करना पड़ेगा कि उससे जो रेडिएशन हो रहा है उसका नुकसान आसपास की आबादी को ना हो. तो उसको आपको उसके ऊपर बहुत सारा कंक्रीट डाल के उसको डीकमीशन करना पड़ेगा.
वो भी साथ
छोड़ेंगे तो वो बहुत खर्चीली भी पड़ती है और उसके साथ समस्याएं भी हैं. तो सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट में मेरे हिसाब से न्यूक्लियर एनर्जी की कोई भूमिका नहीं है. हमें सौर ऊर्जा और पवन ऊर्जा और जो जैव ऊर्जा, इन सब विकल्पों को विकसित करना चाहिए ताकि हम इनसे अपनी ऊर्जा की आवश्यकताओं को पूरा कर सकें.
जी बिल्कुल, बहुत सही है.
जी जी
जी, धन्यवाद भैया.
वी हैव अ क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम सरताज सिंह. सरताज, प्लीज आस्क योर क्वेश्चन.
यस सर. सर, सो कैन सोलर एनर्जी, लाइक यू डिस्कस्ड अ बिट इन बिटवीन, for a country like India, which receives a good amount of sunlight almost all over the year, is important. And like, why is not government pushing it a lot, although it has tried to provide subsidies, but still the cost is a lot. Yeah.
The solar energy.
Yes, he's talking of solar energy.
Okay. This cost thing is very... very dubious, because you know there are number of costs which the government subsidizes. So my short answer is the government should promote what is healthy environmentally, what is safe, and there should be prohibitive cost on things which are not which are bad for the environment. So if the government wants, they can always promote something. And in solar also there are two kinds of technologies. One is the photovoltaic technology, that is costly, I agree. And at this time, the panels are being exported. I mean, they're assembled here, but the components are being exported. But the solar thermal technology, which directly uses sunlight, you might have seen those solar cookers, box type cookers, or the water heater devices on rooftops. So such devices can be used on a larger scale, which can be indigenously manufactured. And there are some problems with photovoltaic, but at this time, that is the only option we have for sustainable use of solar energy. So unless more research is done and we can come up with safer ways of using solar energy, we will have to continue with that.
Thank you. Participants, please keep on sending your questions in the chat box, or you can raise your virtual hand to ask yourself, because we are drawing close to the end of the session. Meanwhile, we have some questions there already. Nivedita Arjun wants to ask a question.
Yeah.
Nivedita.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I agree with you when you say that cities need to be more energy conscious. But yeah, how would you suggest that a city like Mumbai, which is quite active in the night, how would you suggest we conserve electricity in terms of billboards and other sorts of advertisements? Thank you, sir.
See, if you're doing something which is essential, I mean, if you are running a hospital in the night or something like that, or even if you have, I know what you're talking about. I mean, if people are out on the streets in Bombay till very late in the night. So use it if it is required. I'm not saying that you don't use it at all, but don't waste. That is what I'm saying. I mean, there is no need for these advertisement boards to be lighted after midnight, let us say. So, even your local train in Mumbai stops between 1 a.m. and 4 a.m., right? So, similarly, we should use the resources judiciously and not use it when it is not required. So, things which can be done during the daytime without using electricity should be done during daytime, and which are essential, which have to be carried on into the night. I have no problem with it. I'm just saying don't waste electricity.
Yes. Thank you. I'm reminding once again our participants and audience to please ask your questions if you have one. We have two questions from Nisha Tiwari. I think one is a comment and the other is a question. So yeah. Nisha, you can ask both. Maybe you can ask the question first and then the comment, whatever way you want to go. Nisha. Nisha Tiwari.
Yeah, Nisha.
Maybe she's having some trouble with her internet connection. So I will just read her question. One is a comment, and I would say that I also agree with her. She says that pulmonary TB or lung TB symptoms mimic lung cancer symptoms. Because you had mentioned, Dr. Pandey, that the doctors were saying that there were TB patients, but cancer patients there. And often lung cancer patients get wrongly treated for TB. And this happens many times. Yeah. And then when it is too late, then they go to a lung cancer expert. And by that time, perhaps it is too late. So this is one problem. And perhaps that is how they were hiding lung cancer cases under the garb of TB cases. That is a comment she has made.
Yeah, that is what I meant.
Yes, yes. So Nisha also wants to know, how can we exit from nuclear bomb and nuclear plants now?
How can we do what?
Exit from.
Exit.
Yes.
See, we have a very heartening history of nuclear disarmament. There are more countries in the world who have signed on nuclear weapon-free zones. There are countries of the South America. And at one point, you should remember that Brazil and Argentina were also in a race to produce nuclear weapons. And only when they realized the futility of it, they agreed into a pact and constituted a committee of 50 people, various experts, 25 from Argentina and 25 from Brazil. to oversee that, you know, none of the two countries will start their nuclear weapons program again. And all the countries of South America signed a nuclear weapon free zone, which means they will not produce nuclear weapon, nor allow any other country like United States to install its nuclear weapons on the soil. Africa signed a treaty like that, the entire Africa. The Southeast Asian countries signed a treaty. Then countries of South Pacific, Australia, New Zealand signed a treaty. And then five Central Asian countries, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and all these countries also signed a treaty. So there are these five regions in the world and Mongolia. The Mongolian parliament has passed a resolution not to produce a bomb. So together, this is more than 100 countries, more than half the world has signed up, you know, to not produce nuclear weapons. And when the Soviet Union got disintegrated, the nuclear weapons, you know, fell in the custody of, three or four countries. And except for Russia, no other country wanted to keep the nuclear weapons. They just handed over their nuclear weapons to Russia. And they said, we are not capable of, you know, protecting them. So just imagine that more than half the world doesn't believe in keeping nuclear weapons for its security. It is only 9 countries, the 5 Security Council members, that is the United States, Russia, France, England, and China, and India, Pakistan, Israel. Yeah, those are the countries. The 9th one was North Korea, but we are not sure whether, you know, they probably have, but they have promised to dismantle their stockpiles. So only 8 countries and possibly North Korea. Iran is also said to have the capability to produce. So these 5 plus, you know, 4 or 5 countries, 9 or 10 countries have the capacity to have nuclear weapons, and 1 or 2 are not sure whether they would like to have it or not. North Korea has said that it would give up its nuclear weapons. So they are not, you know, now the pandemic crisis has shown that your nuclear weapons are going to be useless against even a small virus. You can't protect your population. Probably 25,000 people would have never died in any war that the United States would go to with any other country in the world, but they have not been able to save their lives, precious lives of their citizens. Now, this is a country which used to take even the death of one soldier in Iraq or Afghanistan very seriously. And imagine they have lost 25,000 people. So it shows that, you know, these weapons are of no use when we are facing, you know, a natural calamity. And I would say that the countries which are antagonistic to other countries should resolve their differences, should resolve their problems. And in this new world where now cooperation is needed more than, you know, confrontation to survive, the countries should work together to evolve a common strategy to deal with problems like the current pandemic, and stop investing in arms and armies because that is not really required. It is such an artificial thing. You know, the day Indian government decides it would like to be friendly with Pakistan, it can be friendly. Mr. Modi can land in Lahore and attend the private family function of Nawaz Sharif and be very friendly with him. And, you know, the day he decides that he doesn't want to be friendly, our soldiers are killing each other on the border. So this is such an artificial thing. It depends totally on the governments, whether they would like to be friends or enemies. So when you have the option, why not choose the better option and become friends and create a world where no weapons or no armies are required, and we can have international boundaries just like we have boundaries between states and districts, where people can just cross over from one side to the other without any passport or visa. So this is my view. I believe that if you think about it, there is really no need. And if more than 100 countries can decide in the world not to have new weapons and it still feels secure, then what is the need for these 9 or 10 countries to keep their stockpiles?
Rightly so. In fact, Rahul Sharma from Hyderabad is more or less echoing these sentiments. He says, why do we need data to prove that nuclear bomb or nuclear energy is good or not? Are Hiroshima and Fukushima disasters not enough evidence to convince governments?
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah.
We have a question from Sartaj. Sartaj wants to ask another question. So Sartaj, please ask your question.
Yes, sir. So I'm really interested in, I think you'll know about the International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor in France, like, which was a collaboration of a lot of countries. So it uses fusion instead of nuclear fission, and as hydrogen's isotopes as its components, and it basically produces helium only as its waste material, which is a non-toxic inert gas, as we all know. So what are your views on that?
Are you talking of the Super Phoenix, the one which uses thorium?
No, sir. It uses isotopes of hydrogen. It's with the plasma physics.
You said it is using fusion, not fission.
Yeah. Yes, sir. It's fusion.
So I have no recollection of about what is the opinion of the arms control group with which I work on that. So I would not be able to answer it at this point. I will have to look it up and then tell you.
Okay, sir.
So you can have my email address, which I'm happy to share with everybody else also, and we can continue our interaction over mail. ashaashram@yahoo.com, ashaashram@yahoo.com. So I'm sorry, I don't have an answer for you at this time, but I will have to look it up and then tell you.
Okay.
We have a question from Mihir Thakur. Maybe this will be the last question we can take up. Mihir, would you like to ask yourself, please?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, sir. I am Mihir. My question is that recently there has been a lot of talk about introducing electric cars in the Indian market, although the market doesn't seem to be very accepting towards that, and it also doesn't seem very confident about it. So how do we ensure that the people are made aware about its advantages, and how do they basically accept this change so that more good can be done to the environment?
See, electric car is not polluting on the road, that's all. But I mean, you are charging it with electricity, which is polluting somewhere else. The thermal power plant, which is producing the electricity. So it is not really an alternative, I would say. It's one of the options that we have. But I think we have to look for more sustainable solutions, because ultimately you are using fossil fuel, to charge your electricity, to charge your car. So the only thing is, you will not pollute on the road. The city pollution will be less. So my answer is that let us look for more environmental friendly options. I mean, can we do without private? For example, can we do without private vehicles? Can we use more public transport? Can we use more cycles and other vehicles which are not powered by fossil fuels? Because electric car in a way is powered by fossil fuel. So I think we have to look for those kind of options then. I mean, people like me and Bobby have been using bicycles to navigate inside the cities, but it is amazing how during the pandemic we have seen people have walked long distances. You know, Bobby can walk from one corner of Lucknow city to another, but there are people who have walked from Gujarat to Assam. Amazing. So we should also question why we need these modern means of especially private transportation. If it is public transportation, it is fine, can be used by everybody, is low cost. So I think we have to move in that direction.
I agree with you, Dr. Pandey, because the whole idea should be actually to reduce the number of cars on the street, no matter what type of fuel they are consuming. And I think many countries in the Western world are going towards that, and they are making use of cars very, very difficult for the owners, making it more expensive for them. But then, as you said, there has to be a very robust public transport system. And navigating by cycles also, we don't have any designated cycle lanes in India. In many other countries, I have seen that there lot many people cycle, and they have designated lanes, so it is safe to cycle. Here, even crossing a road is, I find it so unsafe at times. So the whole idea should be to reduce the number of cars, I think.
Yeah.
We have just one last question, that how to ensure equitable access to energy, as those who consume most of it are not ready to change. And most of the well-lit buildings are often buildings of corporations or maybe government buildings. So individual access versus government-led action, what is the way forward? Because unless the government makes a policy change and the government changes its ways, it may not be easy.
Yeah.
What do you have to say to that?
It is true that that the government policies will ultimately change our, you know, energy use pattern. And hopefully, you know, after this crisis, we would have learned some lesson.
Yes.
And it is true that we waste a lot of electricity and energy. And we have to now think of evolving a new lifestyle which depends less on these energy sources which are non-renewable. So that is my short answer, but it is not very easy. I know that, because we are used to certain lifestyle and we don't want to change. During this pandemic, I think most of the middle and upper middle class did not really get affected in any serious manner, because they could lead their lives comfortably inside homes. It was only the poor who suffered, who did not have any bank balance, whose savings were exhausted, who didn't have anything to eat, no proper place to stay, and that is why they had to walk long distances. So we should think about the entire population and evolve a model of development which is more equitable, where people have more can share the resources in a more equitable manner, and can also enjoy the benefits of development in a more equitable manner. So I have just written an article last night. We need new economic and political models. So I will be happy to share it with Bobby and Shobhaji, and they can share it with the rest of the people who have joined. A lot of people are writing about it. Just yesterday, a doctor from AIIMS has written that maybe now we need a slower pace of life. So similarly, you know, people are talking about different things. So a lot of things will change, I think, in the time to come. Even if we don't want to change, the circumstances will force us to change.
I wish they do, Sandeep Bhai, what we say, inshallah, to what you are saying. And we now come to the end of today's discussion. And we will meet again on Tuesday, May 12 at 1:30 p.m. To be part of a webinar in the lead up to World No Tobacco Day, where we will be interacting with members of parliaments, governors, mayors, and public health experts of countries in the Asia Pacific region. And the link to join this special webinar will be sent to you shortly. Bye till then and stay safe. And our sincere thanks once again to Dr. Sandeep Pandey for this very, very enriching talk and discussion today.
No, thank you. Thank you, Shobha ji, and thank you, everybody, for being patient.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. 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 Pranav.